College of Graduate Studies. He published more than 90 research papers, and he serves as a consultant for many UN organizations. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Chair. I'm going to give, I'm afraid I've been put in this session that will talk about only utilities, but I'm not going to be talking about utilities. I'm going to be talking about the whole water system. So bear with me. And I will be talking, I will be including the utilities anyway. I'm just going to give you a quick brief about the unified water strategy that was made for the GCC. In December 2010, there was a directive by the GCC summit to formulate a unified, comprehensive water strategy for the GCC that takes into account the energy and food sectors into account. And then in 2012, things started to move very fast, and the strategy took about 2 years and a half. It was approved in the last summit in Bahrain in December 2016 by the GCC leaders, and now it is being implemented by some of the countries as a guidelines for their national strategies. So I'm just going to give you a very quick brief on how that thing, how the strategy was developed. Quickly, I'll give a very quick introduction and then try to go over the main challenges that GCC countries are facing, and then we'll go to the GCC water strategy. And I'll show you just a small glimpse of the benefits that can be achieved if this strategy is implemented, and some conclusion recommendation, and then we'll open up for question and answers. I don't think I have to go through this slide a lot, because I think everybody knows that the GCC countries have very low endowment in terms of freshwater resources and renewability. All the GCC countries have less than the acute water poverty line of water share. Despite that acute poverty, they managed to provide water for their population, of course, due to the financial and energy resources available. Currently, we have most of our water goes to the agriculture, and then the municipal, and then the industrial. This is supplied mainly by groundwater. Unfortunately, most of it is fossil, and desalination, and then wastewater. What are the main challenges? The main challenge is that we have a very rapid population growth happening due to the development models that we are adopting in our countries. Municipal water supply is demands are escalating with time, non-stop. That's of course because of population, but you can add to that our consumption patterns as well as some losses in the network. With time, our water supply for the domestic water is actually coming mainly from desalination plants, and you know, the groundwater are not fit for human consumption, because most of them are brackish. The major expansion in desalination, it doesn't come without a cost. It has a very high cost. It is energy intensive. Of course, I think everybody knows that. It has also financial, especially when you are having a subsidy system. You don't recover, cost recovery is becoming very low. And of course, there are some environmental costs. As you know, there are brine discharge to the sea as well as greenhouse gases emissions. The worrying some thing is that it is still an imported technology. We still don't own that technology, although GCC countries own 50% of the total world capacity of desalination. If you look at this graph, you can see the energy intensity with the water scarcity, and you can see the GCC on the side. So we have a very, very strong water energy nexus. It consumes a lot of our energy, you know, desalination in particular consumes a lot of our energy resources. And in certain countries, it reaches 33% of our primary fuel consumption. The other thing is that we are having a Most of our groundwater resources are deteriorating with time. There isn't a single aquifer that's been stabilized. All the groundwater systems are deteriorating or having very steep drawdowns. And of course, when you have drawdowns, you will have a seawater intrusion or connate water outflows. These are impacting the quality and not only are you losing the water sector, but you are losing also the agriculture sector, which is the main cause of that type of overexploitation. The thing is that there is a cause that we are not looking at, which is, I think it can be looked at as an opportunity cause. If you don't have that type of water, where are you going to get the alternative, of course, water? And I think we are overlooking the value of that groundwater so far. In terms of wastewater, we have very, this is a very low wastewater recovery percentage, when you have 50% only. And there's also a mismatch between treatment and reuse. We treat almost all our wastewater, but we don't reuse them. And that's a major opportunity lost under the scarcity condition that we are having. We have to have the international benchmark reached at least in the future. In the municipal sector, we have very low water efficiency, which means adding supply and the use and the recycling and the reusing. And if you look at Bahrain, physical leakage, by the way, this is now 22%. But if you look at Bahrain, physical leakage is about 20%. 20% of that water is not actually only a water, because it is desalinated water, which has a lot of energy put there, and a lot of financial resources has been put in it. If you look at the per capita water consumption, you still see a very high per capita water consumption, except in Oman and Saudi Arabia. You have most of the countries are having above 400 liter per day per capita, which is considered high. If you look at the agricultural consumptions, still some countries, although Saudi Arabia has returned back on agricultural policies, but still there are so many countries in the Gulf that are going ahead with ambitious agricultural programs as a way of distributing their wealth to the people. And these waters are being used in a very low irrigation efficiencies. Our irrigation efficiency is 24%, 25%. Major water is being lost, mainly is groundwater. There is a move toward high cash crops like fodder, which consumes a lot of water compared to others. And this is also being combated, but still there is a lot of the government is not able to control that. And if you look at the source of water, most of our groundwater wells are not metered. Maybe only in Bahrain that we have all the groundwater wells being metered, but most of the countries don't have actually a measure of how much water is being used in the agricultural sector. We go to the water supply and sanitation utilities. We find that they have very, very low level of cost recovery. Of course, it's not in their hand, because even if they are operating as a business or as a private sector, they don't have the liberty to increase the tariffs, because it has to do with the political economy of the countries, which is not supposed to be decided by them as utilities. We can see that we have something like 90% of subsidies. And if you look at, does these subsidies really make sense? You'll find that if you look at the benchmark, the world benchmark between the income and the price, you'll find that the countries are very, very low. I mean, still they can be in the benchmark, but they are still low. Only Oman and Dubai are really within the international benchmarks. And this is means that we are really actually, I mean, the overriding subsidy is a general subsidy, and it's not a targeted subsidy. However, in the recent years, there has been some changes in Bahrain and in Saudi Arabia and in Abu Dhabi. The other issue that's really worrying the GCC countries is that most of our water comes from desalination plants. And when you are having desalination plants, they're taking their water from the Gulf, there are so many hazards that's happening in the Gulf for the source water, well, the feed water for our desalination plants. In the Gulf, actually, there are something like 40,000 to 50,000 tanker or ship that crosses the Arabian Gulf per year. About 80% of those are actually oil tankers. So the accidents or the chances of accidents is very high. Of course, we have the nuclear threat from our neighbors in the north. That can be also a threat. Anything can happen in the Dijla and Farat, Euphrates and Tigris can go to our desalination plants, and that's put a very high risk on our water supply system. The other issue that's really worrying us, which is the enabler, the governance system. The governance system is still not really conducive for a good management. And there is a dominance of sectoral planning and management. The integration is not there because of the fragmentation of the water institutions. And most of the emphasis is actually on the supply side management. We're trying to build desalination plants instead of looking at the leakage or looking at our changing the behavior of the consumer. And if you take all that thing together and try to put it in one graph, you'll find that we are really going in a downward spiral situation, that everything is going down and down and down. The only thing that's keeping this system intact is our abilities, financial abilities and energy abilities to continue doing this. But at certain time, there might be a rupture, especially when you have a shock like the drop in the oil prices. When this happened, we start to realize what's going on. And then we go back and see if we can combine the system. But anyway, that's a system. And the GCC Unified Water Strategy is trying to correct this thing, trying to make the water management system more sustainable in terms of continue to serve the socio-economic development needs as long as it can, which means supplying water to the needed sectors with the required quality with the minimum cost and the most as much as we can. And if you have fossil groundwater, you cannot think about sustainability. You have to think about longevity more than anything else. So that's the vision. And the mission actually is trying to, And the vision is trying to get, foster the joint initiative together, like the water security and the desalination technology and so on, together. And at the level of the countries, we have to have our water level management system elevated to a more efficient system. Those are something like 10 values. We have put almost everything that we can in terms of the contemporary values for water management. There are five pillars. Has to do with the first one with the sustainability of our resources. The second one is this efficiency and equitability. The third is security. The fourth is governance and awareness. And the last one is economic efficiency. These are cross-cut by a lot of issues like capacity building, the climate change, the environment and ecology, and the research and development. We have 10 strategic objectives. The first seven of them, actually, development and enhancement improvement of our water resources. The last three are actually as an uplift of the whole thing. It's a governance, and you know, they take longer time than what we think. But the first one, we can really work on them. The first one has to do with desalination acquiring and also diversification of our energy resources. We have a very strong energy water sector, nexus sector. We have to decouple. Something has to be done about this. The decoupling can be done with the renewable and increasing the efficiency and so on and so on. I don't have the time to go through all these, but we have covered as much as we can. These are the targets of the strategy. By the year 2035 or 2030, we have to achieve a certain amount. For instance, we have to have our leakage less than 10% by the year 20, 35 for our per capita has to be reduced to 250 by this that year, and so on and so on. I'm not going to go through this, but we have done a lot of scenarios to see the impact of implementing this strategy with time, and we have realized that there are so much benefit that the GCC countries can really realize by saving from by looking at the business as usual, as well as when you implement the strategy. We're talking about financial costs reaching 56 billion US dollars saving if we just implement simple things. Not, you don't have to do a lot of things. We did also some scenarios for the wastewater and the agriculture, and we found that some countries, if they really implement this thing, they, you know, Bahrain, Kuwait, and Qatar don't even need to drill to take any groundwater. They can use all the wastewater for their agriculture. Finally, this is, I think, a major milestone. If we apply that, I think we'll be better off a lot. And we have a lot of benefits. As much as there are challenges, there are a lot of potential and benefits. But we fail to do that. I think we will not have the water sector contributing to our socioeconomic development. This is the team that has done the work. It's not me. I'm just doing it on their behalf. We have a team from all the GCC countries. That they are all nationals. They have done the work together under the auspices and the follow-up by the GCC, and as well as the countries of the member country for the GCC. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Waleed.
Sorry about this.
And now with Dr. Muwaffaq Saqqar. He will talk about a strategic decision combating corruption in the wastewater sector in the Arab countries. Dr. Muwaffaq holds a PhD in water environmental engineering from Newcastle University in England, and BS in civil engineering and master in water engineering from the University of Jordan. He was a senior official in the Ministry of Water and Irrigation in Jordan, directed the Amman Zarqa Wastewater Master Plan, coordinated the Water Quality Improvement and Conservation Project, managed Al Samra Wastewater Treatment Plant. Good.
Thank you, Chairman. My topic will be about combating corruption in the water sector in the Arab countries. As you know, most water engineers are always focusing on technical issues in water scarcity, inefficient water, and limited public participation, and the lack of data. But there is a big challenge for the water sector in the Arab countries, which is the spread of corruption.
And where is that?
ممكن بلا شوي انا كيف بدنا نوصلها ثاني وين هذا اوكي هذا اوكي جاست ان انتدكشن اند جاست تو شير ذات كوربشن از ا جلوبال ايشيو. Corruption is present in all sectors and in all regions and in all Arab countries. It was noticed also that the corruption level in a particular country is highly correlated to the soundness of the justice system, integrity, the fairness, the independence, the strength and quickness, and execution of court orders, and applying the principle that no one is above the law. In terms of corruption size, we can say that there is a grand corruption, which is the huge corruption, and the petty corruption, the small size corruption. Corruption is spread in the countries, rare in some, European countries, widespread as most Arab countries are under this category, and systematic. Systematic, that means that nothing can move without some corrupt practices. Unfortunately, that the trend in the Arab countries, they are moving from the widespread into the systematic corruption.
This is the common forms of corruption, the misconducts, it's a bribery, rashwa, fraud, ihtiyal, collusion, tawato, theft, sariqa, extortion, ibtizaz, favoritism, mahsubiyya, obstruction, arqala, wa combination of more than one form. And this is the last one, is the common form that's